And you know what he said to the British Prime Minister at the time? So he says, if you're going to take Haiti and return slavery to Haiti, you need an army of 20,000 or more. But just remember this. Kill the women first before you kill the men. They wiped him out. After Haiti, slavery was no longer economical. And it led to the end of slavery in America.
Beverly Bryan is now based in Jamaica, so we interviewed her by Skype. In that interview, she talks us through the role of the supplementary schools.
I was always interested in, I don't know why, because out of all of my brothers and sisters, there are 8 of us, I was the eldest and I was the only one who got involved in political organization as such. In school, my experiences at school was that there was a certain amount, I did have to deal with racism in school, because I used to fight in school. When children picked on me, called me racist names, as I did all the time, I would fight. Because I think maybe so why I joined, I think it's because it's my spirit. I'm an eldest child, I'm a Leo, I'm somebody, if you don't deal with me right, I will come back at you. But on the institutional level, there was a system of education that did not allow all children to reach their full potential. And the race part of it was that black children were always in those poor schools because they didn't understand the system. So, I think that is the most important aspect of racism. It's not just about personal things, people calling you names. I don't think you have that so much in England. But the institutions are still kind of locked in a structure that doesn't always allow poor as well as black people to succeed. And people were very fiery. Some of us, more fiery than others. But, people did what the main things they were concerned with was the action of the police, the education, and the education system. And there were some cultural activities as well. I think we have to remember that the Panthers and the Panthers in Princeton had that first school at 36 Shakespeare Road for many years. And people like myself and Linton, we worked in that school. We would go to the local area and brought them to Shakespeare Road, and we'd have classes in English, math, in black history. We did a lot of drama and so on. And I think a lot of those young people came for the cultural things because we had a lot of dances with sound system. I'll forget the names of some of them, but there are other groups in the area, in other parts as well, who used to come to them. Like we had the Fasimbas, which was in a group in Catford and Lewisham. And in fact, my husband, who's my similar husband, I met him at one of those meetings in South London. It was about upliftment of the community in education, housing, and support for those involved with the police.
To hear the complete recordings and see video and photo footage of this project, www.organizeyouth.com. Dunlop joined the Panthers as a teenager. As a self-taught photographer, he became the official photographer of the British Black Panther movement.
And I wanted to go to a disco, and they say I was a bit late. So I should come back next week. So I returned the following week in my suit and tie. And those days, you've got to go out in suit, not like guys. There were no trainers and track suit. Everybody had to be well-dressed. And they said, sorry, you can't come in. I said, why? He said, well, we don't want your type here. I said, why? Well, we haven't done anything. We're well-dressed. We behave ourselves. So why not let us in? I said, well, we don't want you. You should go. And as usual, when you say to a black person, go, they want to stay. So I said, I'm not going. And they said, we'll call the police. So they called the police. Police came. It was an inspector, and the one with plain clothes, not uniform. And he said, you should go. They don't want you here. They don't want your type here. So I say, I don't see any reason why we should not be there. We should not come. And they said, well, you know, they don't want you, so if you don't leave, I'm going to arrest you. And at that moment, I thought, why should I get my parents to be so stressed to come to Stratton Police Station to take me out, and how shocking it would be for them. So I said, okay, I'll leave, and I left. But on my way home, I decided that I'm going to fight against injustice and fairness in this country. So about 2 weeks later, I was in Brixton, and I saw the Black Panthers giving out leaflets, inviting people to come to their meeting to hear about discrimination and how to, you know, fight and organize and educate ourselves. And that's how I got in the Panther.
Organised Youth.
This poem is vexed about apartheid, racism, fascism, the Ku Klux Klan, riots in Brixton.
Farouk Dondi was part of the Central Committee.
A friend of mine, a painter called Vivan Sundaram, said to me, the only disciplined group amongst all these voices is the Black Panther movement. The Black Panther movement is hard, and the civilized movement is soft, because it's non-violent. Althea Jones was a very inspiring speaker. You could get a crowd on her side anytime. One day, Darkus brought his uncle, C.L.R. James, to the meeting. C.L.R. James was a real inspiration. What the Black Panther movement did initially was to give mostly the children of working immigrants a place to belong and an identity and a feeling that we are a force, we are somebody, we are a dimension in the world. We're not just somebody's servants here. But just to say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud, you know, had to pass into the blood at the time. And it did.
Layla Howe was a member of the Black Unity and Freedom Party.
The house in which I lived, like Darkus, relied heavily on the BBC for information and news, and we would talk a lot about the politics of the world. So I grew up in a very knowing the world and politics before I came to England. So when I came to England and came to live with my mother, back in East London in Plaistow, which is Canning Town, most of my uncles were in the docks and the wharves, and they were big supporters of Enoch Powell, who made the famous Rivers of Blood speech. I went to school, there were three of us, I think, black children who were absolutely vilified and hated. The big thing I remember for me that probably was a turning point, I was married to an African from Sierra Leone, and he was one of the people who Darkus described who believed that black people had to keep their head down, work hard, try and get on with the English and not kick up any fuss about what was happening to ordinary black people. And I remember on the television seeing Huey P. Newton on the bridge at Oakland with a gun and a black beret, and I remember him talking and saying how we had to stand up for ourselves and our rights. And I think that for me, if I go back, that was the turning point for me when I thought, no, I'm going to join something and do something myself.
We had spent our energy complaining to the police about the police and nothing was done, complained to the courts about the courts and nothing was done, and that it left us with no alternative but to actually come onto the streets to demonstrate what we felt about the repression. We had to do something. Mostly young people, it was powerful in the sense that you had at least, there were probably about almost 200 of us who were there on the street, and we were shouting slogans. Suddenly the police attacked the demonstration. I was charged with a fray. I was charged with possession of offensive weapon, and I was charged with riot. Did I use an offensive weapon? I used a placard to hit a policeman. Did I riot? No, I was demonstrating. Yeah. So I spent the night in the police cells. My son was 1 year old at the time. It was important to us that we used the trial itself as a vehicle for mobilising and really communicating to the wider black population exactly what was happening and why this was such a groundbreaking moment for black people at that time in this country. And we did, and it was fantastic. There were some very, very strong black women within the movement, but yeah, it was dominated by black men. So that led to those kinds of organisation by black women, for black women. There were a lot of women who committed themselves to self-organisation at that time, and they played a pivotal role, and that, you know, that really ought to be remembered.
We're sick and tired of your ism, schism, game, dine and go to heaven in Jesus' name, Lord. We know and we understand Almighty God is a living man. You can fool some people sometimes, but you can't fool all the people all the time. So now we see the light. What you gonna, we gonna stand up for, yeah, all right, yeah. So you better get up, stand up in the morning, give it up, stand up for your right, stand up right now, get up.
Althea Jones-Lecionte was the head of the Panthers in the UK. She explained to us how a resistance movement is set up.
When you're saying go on the street, you're fighting for the story, blah, blah, blah. But you know in theory about, you know, family, how we're not here as individuals, we're here as a group. What I'm saying is that we experienced the constriction of our space in our generation. You are experiencing the constriction of your space in your generation. It is that idea that somebody is constricting your space, some idea is constricting your space, some ideology is constricting your space, some perception of who you should be is constricting your space, that brings you together in a common purpose. You want to organize yourself, you organize yourself, you call two or three people together, you have the same point of view, you feel the same about what you want, and you start asking, what are our questions? That's how you start. What are our questions? What are our issues? Right? The Black Panther movement put out this list. We want better housing. We want better education. We want, you know, the end to police brutality. Well, I don't think you've achieved that. But, you know, and according to what you just told me, you've got better housing. You've got benefits. You know, you've got a brilliant education. You know, so, right. So those things have been achieved. So it comes back to the question that I said to you. What are your issues? What are the things that challenge you?
British Black Panther.